When the Virgin New Adventures began, there was a rush, an avalanche of hopeful young writers who wanted to put their stamp on a Doctor Who. Now, the natural inclination is to want to be the first writer for the series, to have that number one spot that everybody trying to get into the series will read first, to try and set the standards to which the series will respond to. That's what John Peel petitioned for, and that's what he got, for better or for worse. But actually, the thing you really want is to be the first returning writer for the series. A few reasons for that. One, it shows the world that this publication trusts your word, giving whatever you do an added sense of authority. Two, in the democracy of ideas, you find yourself with a majority vote. Your characterizations, your ideas, they beat out everybody else's 2-1. Even if you don't end up writing any other books for the series, you still have that initial creative authority, which overrules that of whoever got that first book slot. And it would take time and effort for this new creative authority to be overruled by somebody else. Of course, this book is much more than just the first book from a returning author, because it's the book where everything changes. Before this point, if Doctor Who had suddenly returned to television with the Seventh Doctor and Ace returning as if they had never left, you could still pass some of these eight books as a continuation of the show. With this book, The Virgin New Adventures hits the point of no return, the point where it stops being a continuation of the show and much more its own thing, something that a returning Doctor Who almost certainly would not compensate for. Being the author hired to bring about this change is no small task, and the resulting book is going to be a bigger deal than the first book in the series. Everything before this was just preamble. This is when The Virgin New Adventures truly begins. This is Love and War by Paul Cornell. By the 26th century, the human race had managed to spread across the stars, and with that came a whole host of conflicts with various alien empires, most notably the Draconians, sophisticated reptilian humanoids. Despite the machinations of the Time Lord known as the Master, the Draconians and humanity found peace and partnership in face of a far greater threat, the Daleks. Their war against the Daleks has displaced a lot of people, creating large nomadic communities in need of neutral ground to stay. What was needed was a planet, one able to sustain life, one that was far away from the battlefield, one that didn't have much in the way of mineral resources or strategic value as to not draw in would-be conquerors. And they found such a planet, a small, quiet, green planet, and they named it Heaven. While a place for refugees, it also became the gravesite for the millions killed during the war, their bodies sent down in pods to be buried. Heaven was once the home of a long-lost civilization. Their ancient monoliths still dot the landscape, which grabs the attention of Professor Bernice Summerfield, a space-hopping archaeologist, who spends her time on Heaven with the Travelers, a group of spacefaring pagans who get by bartering and busking. While out in the market square, one of the Travelers, a young man named Jan, crosses paths with a strange girl from another world named Ace. Ace and the Doctor have arrived on Heaven in search for an ancient manuscript, the Papers of Felsikar, for reasons only the Doctor are privy to. Ace and Jan make a connection, in more ways than one. They have sex. And Ace wonders where her life might go from here. Surely she can make a romantic relationship work alongside her travels with the Doctor. However, where the Doctor goes, the monsters follow. The long-lost civilization, they had fallen prey to the Houthi, a fungal race that infects other living creatures, see through their eyes, absorb their memories into a collective, infiltrate and conquer without anybody realizing it. Oh, did I say living creatures? Because they also reanimate dead bodies, and Heaven is basically a planet-sized graveyard. This is not a healthy combination. Also, the Houthi fly about space in gas-inflated balloons made of flesh, and if that isn't the most heavy metal thing Doctor Who's ever done, I don't know what is. The Doctor has a plan in dealing with these guys, well, doesn't he always, but if he goes through with it, it might mean hurting Ace. Not for the first time, but certainly the greatest hurt he's ever inflicted on her. Surely there's another way. Surely. There's 101 places I could start with this book. And it's not finding a subject to talk about that's the hard part, it's finding a subject that hasn't been covered by so many other reviews over the years. This is the flagship book for the Virgin New Adventures. This is the jumping on point. This is the one everybody talks about. So let's start with the title, Love and War. It seems generic for a title, doesn't seem to reference anything specific. As far as dualities go, it's fairly basic. A lot of stories deal with love and war, peace and conflict, but its duality is not only pertinent to this book, but has been a point of consideration for Doctor Who writers, something that came into the sharpest focus during the Wilderness years. What should Doctor Who be more about? Love or war? On the one hand, Doctor Who stories are almost always driven by violent conflict. A Doctor Who story where nobody dies a horrible death is so rare that it's often the source of emotional catharsis. The amount of violence on hand became a point of contention in the late 1970s when social conservative activist Mary Whitehouse became vocally critical of it. She once referred to the show as "Tea Time Brutality for Tots." And while Whitehouse was a horrible, horrible person, she wasn't technically wrong on that account. Doctor Who is a violent show. War and conflict are part of its DNA. And while it is not exclusively a children's program, children do make up a large part of its viewer base, and that has to be accounted for. And I would say, at its best, Doctor Who does account for it. And that's where love comes in. Compassion, understanding, forgiveness, these are positions that the Doctor often finds himself in over his opponents, things he'd prefer to utilize over just blowing them away. Consider the Third Doctor, the Doctor most often associated with action and violence, the Doctor who knows martial arts. And when he's approached by a menacing lizard monster of unknown origins, the Doctor's instinct is to stick out his hand in greetings and attempt communication with it. The Third Doctor, the one who uses guns and swords, was also, I would argue, the most likely to seek a peaceful solution. He would approach alien presences with respect, open up negotiations. He was critical of the military organization he worked for and occasionally undermined their capability towards violent actions. The Fifth Doctor was less violent overall, but he was also less capable of stopping violence, much to the chagrin of fans who preferred a more proactive Doctor. What's interesting, and certainly relevant to this book, is that these are lessons that the Doctor has to be consistently reminded of and relearn from time to time. Hell, many would argue he didn't become the Doctor until sometime after he attempted to kill a wounded caveman with a rock. When Ian intervened, he demonstrated a level of human compassion that rubbed off on the Doctor and led to the Doctor's affection for the human race. However, with his personality getting twisted around with every regeneration, and just the fact that he's really old and forgets a lot about what he's learned, his relationship to love and war tends to change. There's an imbalance to how much compassion and how much violence he utilizes, and this is usually the source of character conflict in regards to the Doctor. Consider the 12th Doctor. A major part of his characterization is that he seems to have lost much of his capability to empathize and be affectionate. He actively puts other people in danger and sometimes straight up abandons his friends for his own reasons, which he doesn't do out of hate, but because there's a major blind spot on his ability to be compassionate. He's not a hugger anymore, and one of the major ideas of the 12th Doctor's first season was questioning if the Doctor was still a good person. Contrast that with the 10th Doctor. At the end of his run, the Earth had been taken over by a madman, a problem that was easy to fix. Just pull the trigger. One bullet, the world is saved. But this Doctor's overwhelming compassion and emotional state blinds him from seeing what must be done. They're pretty much on the opposite ends of the love and war graph, at least they are at those specific moments. This divide, this categorization, is going to evolve in some pretty interesting ways over the Wilderness years, but we'll get into that when we get into Gareth Roberts. So where does the 7th Doctor fall into this? Well, he doesn't lack affection. He's all down for having fun and goofing off, but his relationship with people is a secondary priority to preventing and destroying the spread of evil. He cares deeply for Ace, but he will betray her trust if that's what it'll take to win. His relationship to violence is such that he detests it on a personal level when it's a one-on-one battle to the death. He'd rather talk down a sniper than end him. However, he seems to have no problem with mass, near-genocidal destruction. Scarrow, home planet of the Daleks, Kaboom! A massive fleet of Cybermen vaporized. He sometimes tries to justify it by tricking his enemies into destroying themselves, but he still puts these plans into motion with the intent for this massive elimination of his enemies. Interestingly, this is almost the complete opposite to the Sixth Doctor. The Sixth Doctor has no qualms getting his hands dirty, getting up close and personal, and ending his foes. He'll push you into a vat of acid and make a joke about it afterwards. However, when he ends up complicit in the genocide of an entire alien race, this becomes a major source of personal drama for him, and he's even put on trial for it. It's the mass murder that bothers him, not so much the trying to choke Perry to death. The conflict in character between the Sixth and Seventh Doctor is actually raised in this book, in a maybe it's a dream, maybe it's real sequence, where Ace witnesses the Doctor having a conversation with Death, the same manifestation of Death we saw back in Time Worm Revelation. I've come to bargain with you. Again. The way I bargain with you, I should entertain every life of every cat. You only have 13 to give me, Time Lord. I gave you my 6th life for wisdom. Death laughed and raised a soft finger between the Doctor's eyes. Don't lie to me. You sacrificed the colorful jester because you needed to be born. Time would have her champion, and he was just the compost for your blooming. You ran your TARDIS into the Ronnie's beam joyfully. Ha! Ah, your 6th self hates you for that. He will become the Valyard for that. Yes, I know. Now I offer myself. The 7th Doctor had his own love and war conflict in Time War Revelation, where he sought to destroy his enemies before realizing he could save his enemy from themselves. However, the Time Worm was a much more magical and metaphorical villain, while the Houthi are physical and direct. They're basically an intelligent disease, a fungal infestation bent on domination. That's a lot harder to negotiate with and almost impossible to deal with outside of that mass destruction the Seventh Doctor loves so much. Basically, in Time Worm Revelation, the Doctor wants to war but has to love, while in this book, he wants to love, but has to war. They trudged down into the valley. Bernice looked at the Doctor occasionally as they went. So, she asked, do you have a girlfriend? No. Boyfriend? No. Model railway set? Somewhere. The Doctor was staring down into the valley, observing the fiery shapes that lay there. The TARDIS is full of surprises. But you're not the sort of person who keeps a big table with tiny trees and signal boxes and things. No. Ah, then you must be interested in Law and Order. The Doctor stopped and turned to face Bernice. No, he said, a slow grin spreading over his features. I like chaos, big explosions, rebellions, that sort of thing. Why do you ask? Because I want to know why you go around in a police box. You know what one is? It's from my favorite era. I could have changed it ages ago, the Doctor confided, but I like the shape, and the motto, call here for help. That's what I do. I let little children sleep safely at night because I've searched through all the shadows and traced the baddies away. I'm what monsters have nightmares about. He sounded quite satisfied with that for a moment, and Bernice smiled, but as they approached the fires that gutted and flared in the valley, she could see from his face that he wasn't content with his definition of himself. But everybody's a monster sometimes. The Doctor's plan to stop the Houthi involves Ace's new love interest, Jan. Some time ago, Jan was involved in some shady experiments that gave him pyrokinesis, the ability to produce flame from nothing. Not in a big major way, it's pretty localized, it's not like he's the Human Torch, but we're talking fire attacks versus plant monsters, and I've played enough Pokemon to know how that turns out. And the Houthi ship is a gas-filled space dirigible, meaning it's rather suspect to igniting. Of course, you have to get in it to light it up, meaning Jan has to get into it. And the only way Jan is getting into it is if he becomes infected by the Houthi. The Doctor knows this, and he can't bring himself to tell Ace. Sighing, Ace took the Doctor's scarf in her hands. I am never, ever going to leave you. You needn't worry, you sad old man. Come here. They hugged. Ace felt the Doctor relax, but only slightly. This was way disturbing, the whole bit. Usually he was up on the whole game. way beyond anything dull and stupid like jealousy. She was used to him being in control. The idea that he wasn't was scary. "Will you think about giving Jan a lift?" she asked. "Please? I can't choose between you." The doctor put a hand up to her cheek and touched it gently. "You won't have to choose," he whispered. Ace saw the infinite sadness in his eyes. This is the third time in 9 books that Ace has become emotionally and physically attracted to a young man whom the doctor has separated her from. First, there is Raphael in Time Worm Apocalypse, naive, simple, someone for Ace to be protective over, as much a student as a potential lover. The doctor fed him into a god machine. Then there was Robin in Nightshade, who represented an idyllic, domesticated lifestyle, which seems at odds with Ace's character, but perhaps it was time to move on with her life, retire just like the doctor was considering at the time. The doctor, in turn, separated the two and refused to reunite them. Incidentally, months have gone by between Nightshade and Love and War because Ace seems to have largely forgiven the doctor for that. And finally, there's Jan. Jan is far more Ace's equal in terms of personality, belief, and a shared affinity for explosions. Jan is a member of the Travelers, a spacefaring extension of the Travelers movement that rose in Great Britain during the 1970s. These people adopted various New Age and hippie beliefs, drove around in refurbished buses and vans, and would set up a lot of free festivals across the country, the later of which would be met with a lot of public derision and police suppression. Generally speaking, the public hated these guys, the fear of corruptive anarchist lifestyles. And in 1992, the same year this book was published, the world saw a massive attack on the movement. In May of that year, there was the Castle Morton Common Festival, which was an impromptu free festival in Malvern after law enforcement had forced out a similar festival near Bristol. The outcry against this event led to legislation known as the Criminal Justice and Public Order Act 1994, which sought to put greater restrictions on antisocial behavior by strengthening laws against raves, squatters, and unauthorized camping, as well as giving law enforcement more tools for conviction. For example, one's right to silence, remaining quiet to avoid self-incrimination, could be used to draw inference, or, you know, incrimination. Police had greater rights to obtain body samples and perform unsupervised frisking. It was a pretty bad deal. Obviously, this is all post-Love and War, but the writing was on the wall before then, and things turn out even worse for the Travelers in this book. Things are actually heightened to extreme metaphors, as, you know, Doctor Who do. There's a number of authority figures who seek to suppress the Travelers in some way. There's the actual governing body of Heaven, who aren't exactly pleased with their presence there. There's the Houthi, who see this planet as theirs and everyone on it as cattle. And then there's the Doctor himself. You would think that the Doctor would have something in common with these guys. He's his own kind of space nomad, but he is of a higher class than them. I don't really mean in a specifically British working class versus upper class sort of way, though I'm sure there's that too. I mean that the Doctor is positioned as a higher class of being than humanity, and while on a personal level he makes strong connections and friendships, he still approaches problems with the authority of a governing body. The Doctor knows the big picture, and the Doctor knows best. This is the book that officially gives the Seventh Doctor the title of Time's Champion, but never with a positive connotation. It's a mocking phrase, one used by both his enemies and the friends he has hurt. While Ace considers the Doctor a dear friend, she is in her own way a traveler, a lower class to the Doctor, who during the television era would put her into compromising situations because he felt it best for her personally. While the Doctor cares deeply for Ace, she is still a traveler, still a human, still a lost little girl from Ice World. Except she's not. She's grown, she's proven herself time and again. She's not the Doctor's little girl anymore, and won't stand for his controlling nature, won't stand for what he did to Jan. So, she leaves. Ace leaves the Doctor and the TARDIS behind to make her own way across the galaxy. Yes, I'm still doing these spotlights for authors we've already talked about. My intent is that the author's first spotlight, they get a kind of mini-bio and a look at their work before the Wilderness Years, and each one after that will cover the work they did between books. But Paul Cornell got back on the saddle super quick. Only 10 months have passed between Time War Revelation and Love and War, which is a pretty fast turnaround. I doubt Cornell could have found time to write a haiku in that. The one thing Cornell did manage to do while writing this book was read Neil Gaiman's Sandman. At a particularly uneventful signing in Lancaster, where 7 fanboys turned up in 10 hours, I read the whole of the Dream Country sequence in Sandman, especially the wonderful Shakespeare episode, and wrote a whole chapter in a very short time for the new book. Oh crap, did somebody mention Sandman? No, I'm spiraling down into a masturbatory self-expression, no! The Dream Country sequence consists of 4 standalone stories. Not all that thematically tied to each other, actually, and largely not tied to Love and War, but you can definitely feel the Neil Gaiman influence throughout Cornell's work, not the least of which is using a feminine personification of death, though Gaiman's death and Cornell's death are otherwise pretty different. In Sandman, the boundaries between reality, fiction, and mythology blur or even don't exist at all, and that kind of stuff was all over Time War Revelation. Love and War dials it back a notch, but we still have some mind-bending mythology humping in the form of pewter space, a computer matrix on heaven that people can jack their brains into. Technologically speaking, it's all cyberpunk, but artistically speaking, it's essentially a dreamscape, represented by a vast field built from the collective minds of the travelers. And when you've got the minds of 100 people with alternative belief systems pouring in, the systems in pewter space begin to take some interesting forms. In the center of a clearing was a desk, and on it stood a goblet, shining gold in the sunlight. A man sat behind the desk, a crooked grin on his face. He wore an old-fashioned blue suit and had slicked back black hair. "You would not believe," he said to the 2 adventurers, "what's been going on around here." "The trickster," Jan breathed. "Not this again. Why do I always have to go through this?" Ace had recognized the figure instantly and frowned at Jan's fearful face. "Come on," she muttered. "He's nothing to be afraid of. That's Arlen Jardles, the Barlin comedian, I know, but he's really the trickster, the archetypal god of universal jokes. And this joke's on me because he shows me that goblet every time." This kind of stuff, of touching on mythologies through science fiction concepts, is revealing itself as something of a signature for Cornell. This stuff didn't really need to be in this book. There's a smaller conspiracy involving pewter space, but it wouldn't have been too hard to rewrite things to drop the idea entirely. No, this is material Cornell wants to cover. It's one of his general interests, and there is parallel in these ancient stories to the ones we write now, especially the ones we write with little oversight. I maintain that there's nothing useless or silly or sad about being a Who author. I mean, writing Doctor Who is writing mainstream legend. It's writing modern myths. It's open-ended. You can use mythical elements. You have a guaranteed audience. You can piss off the fanboy audience, which I'm always in favor of doing. You're allowed to do so much. Every time I've talked to Darvill Evans, I've expected him to say, "Cut the lesbianism, cut the violence, cut the politics, cut the sex." But all he's ever complained about is continuity. So you've got huge freedom to do what you like, as long as you stay within continuity. Love and War deals directly with the idea of a mythologized doctor, an idea that didn't really come in vogue until the new series. This is the book that gives the doctor the nickname the Oncoming Storm, though here it's given to him by the Draconians and not the Daleks. This is the time when the doctor could start throwing around his reputation as a weapon, an idea that Stephen Moffat would really get into for a while during his run in the series. In fact, Love and War feels like a major step towards the creative decisions that would be made during the Moffat era of the show. The Seventh Doctor's actions in this book remind me a lot of the 11th Doctor's actions in The Girl Who Waited. An enemy raising an army of undead is pretty much the plot to Darkwater. Pewter space bears some visual similarities to how the Doctor interacts with the cyber planner in Nightmare in Silver. Oh, and also there's a time-traveling archaeologist who can take care of herself. Yes, it's time for the main event. Time to talk about Professor Bernice Summerfield, the Doctor's new companion and the breakout character of the entire Wilderness years. So creating a new companion character can be a very tricky task. It's a creative decision that's just as important as designing the new personality of a regenerated Doctor. The companions are a solid 50% of the driving force of any given Doctor Who story. Sometimes as victims that need to be saved, sometimes as partners in crime, sometimes doing their own thing. Their presence guarantees a plot B to your plot A, and the way the Doctor and his companions interact are going to be the consistent factor in a series of vastly different science fiction adventure stories. So what does Benny bring to the table? Well, for one, she's 30, which isn't old by any stretch, but in comparison to the vast majority of Doctor Who companions, she may as well be a grandma. Doctor Who companions being bright-eyed youths is pretty much codified at this point. Exceptions tend to be pretty notable. Characters like Ian and Barbara, the Brigadier, Liz Shaw, Romana, they stand out because they could approach the Doctor less like students and more like equals. Benny is the same way. She's an experienced intergalactic explorer. She knows her way around alien tech. She already knows full well who the Daleks are, no need to explain those to her. She can keep up just fine. This is demonstrated in Benny and the Doctor's first scene together, where they both explore some of Heaven's ruins and try to figure out what their deal is. It was a skeleton, a tall, rather top-heavy creature with an angular skull. It was hanging from three manacles, chained to the wall. The remaining manacle hung free behind the thing's ribcage, the arm swinging lightly in the air that had entered the chamber. "Ritual sacrifice?" suggested Bernice, then corrected herself. "No, that's just the sort of assumption I hate." "Indeed." The Doctor reached out his umbrella and gently tapped the shackles. "This is a scientific building. Have a look at the device over there." Benny gently stepped up to the podium and, without touching it, examined the long rod that was balanced amid a mesh of gears and levers. "Ah, a telescope. A refractor. Not amazingly powerful. Didn't have to be since this observatory's underground." She put her eye to the telescope and sighed. "I see absolutely no ships." "The shackles don't belong here. They've been roughly welded to the wall. You can see the heat marks. He wasn't wounded," the Doctor was musing. "Or at least his bones weren't broken." "She." Benny hopped off the podium and joined him. "Or a male who just happened to have a huge pelvic girdle. Mammalian, probably something like a bear with an opposable thumb." "Oh, yes, I see." "What?" The Doctor frowned as Benny stood in front of the skeletal creature. She mimicked doing up the shackles on both her legs, then the one on the right arm. "She was left-handed, unlike me. She couldn't fasten her own left cuff with only one free hand." "Yes." The Doctor dropped to his knees and began to scuffle about the floor. "No need to grovel," said Benny. "I'm fairly secure in my brilliance." "You managed to find?" The Doctor suddenly spotted something and grabbed it, holding it up to the light. A tiny sliver of metal. "The key." Benny also has, like, her own thing, man. Her mother died during a Dalek attack, and her father, a bigwig in Space Fleet, disappeared during the war when Benny was still a child. Some believe her father ran off, abandoned his post and his family, but Benny is convinced otherwise, and wants to find the truth. Bernice Summerfield does have a curious, wandering soul that makes travels with the Doctor appealing, but she also has her own agenda, a bit of personal motivation to keep her focused and on point while not overriding the structure of Doctor Who itself. The majority of companions tend to just be tag-alongs, getting dragged along with whatever the Doctor is about at any given moment. Reactive, rarely proactive. And while there will be plenty of reacting in the coming books, there's still that proactive element to her character when you need it. Also, she's not technically a professor. She faked her qualifications as a mean to get out of her situation, and has been writing that lie to get herself all the way across the galaxy. Which is not to say that she isn't smart. She's whip smart. She's archaeologist smart. But there are systems in place. Systems of education, systems of class, gates that have gatekeepers, even this far into the future. Things Benny has to cheat and lie and work around to get what she wants. She has the intelligence for this job, but also the social empathy to get along wonderfully with people of lower class, like the Travelers. In that, she's kind of the Doctor's inverse, a lower class cosplaying as a higher class, while the Doctor is a higher class cosplaying as a lower class. And finally, her introduction to the Doctor is him at his worst, him at his most manipulative, him sending so many innocent people to their deaths to win, him hurting the person closest to him. Which, you know, isn't the greatest sales pitch, When there's nothing at stake, she gets along with him well, and he feels she can't pass up this opportunity to have free access over all of time and space. But she makes her boundaries clear. "I'm the doctor." The doctor shook himself by the hand. "And I will obey you? Or are you going to have a little phrase to introduce me with?" "I'm the doctor, and this is my friend Benny?" "Sounds bloody awful. How about partner?" "Can't we be friends? I don't know you well enough." The doctor put a hand on Benny's shoulder. She took it away again. "Please don't touch me. You're very tactile, and I'm not really. I'd prefer if you didn't." "I'm the doctor." The doctor frowned, looking around for inspiration. "I know that I am. I'm just confused. I need your help." I love this moment. Even though the doctor is having a moment of weakness, and even though the doctor offers something Benny wants, she will not take any crap or allow the doctor to invade her personal space. It's a daring choice for companion at this time, someone who will not stand to be manipulated at a time when the doctor was at his most manipulative, someone who stands as the doctor's equal. As I brought up at the start of this video, Cornell being the first returning writer for the series means that he basically becomes the defining voice for the Virgin New Adventures, which in turn also means the back cover mantra of stories too broad and too deep for the small screen can begin to coalesce into something much more concrete. Violence? Yes. Cornell's violence is often sudden and shocking. There's a penchant for body horror, the human form twisted in grotesque ways. Sex? Yes, but not gratuitous. No titillation, just matter of fact. Ace is sexually active in this book, and we learn some of her sexual history, but it's not anything but frank, grown-up discussions of recreational sex. There's nothing pornographic here. Deeper literary themes and allusions? Oh hell yes! Obviously not everybody's going to be interested in Cornell's repurposed mythology, but opening that door let any potential future authors know, hey, you know all that lit theory you learned in university? Now you can pour it all into a Doctor Who story and get paid for it. But most of all, Cornell's broad and deep Doctor Who is about adulthood and our coming to terms with it. It's about the decisions we have to make as adults and how those decisions affect and in many cases hurt the people we hold close to us. It's about trust. In Time Worm Revelation, the Doctor's trust in Ace is what allows him to find the alternative path he is looking for. In Love and War, the Doctor again feels that there's no alternative, but this time, he doesn't let Ace in, doesn't put his trust in her, and ends up hurting her badly. He's a possessive father who can't let his little girl go, except Ace isn't his little girl, and he needs to realize that. So instead, the Doctor finds himself teamed up with another adult, someone who recognizes the consequences of decisions like this, someone with the experience to not be treated like a child. The Doctor and Benny do not have a friendship, at least not initially. Instead, they have a partnership, because adult Doctor Who is about adults. Also, Bernice Summerfield was modeled after Emma Thompson, which is perfect, and I love it, and I love Benny, and I love you all. The importance of this book to the Virgin New Adventures cannot be understated. With Ace's departure and the introduction of Professor Bernice Summerfield, this series has made the jump into being its own thing, something now separate from televised Doctor Who. When it was still the Doctor and Ace, you could still get away with it being an extension of the show, a bit of spin-off media to hold things off while the show took a break. The possibility of the show's return was never off the table, but by 1992 it had seemed a lot less likely, and with a new influx of creative new writers trying to break in, it was time for the books to take some risks and become their own thing. If Doctor Who should come back and contradict what Virgin did in their books, well, so be it. As such, this book is a great jumping on point for new readers. In many ways, the previous 8 books were kind of a warm-up. We made some contacts, worked out the kinks for this whole publishing thing. Let's really get into this. Which is not to downplay those first 8 books. There's some quality stuff in there, and in fact, if you were to ask me which of the Cornell books I prefer thus far, I personally enjoy reading Time or Revelation a little bit more. For entirely subjective reasons, mind you. I like how it's exploding with ideas, and lately I've been more in the mood for happy endings. However, time warp revelation is nearly impenetrable if you're not already a Doctor Who fan, and even then it's kind of a struggle. And Love and War is tighter, more restrained, and better constructed. It's more accessible, and just a damn good book to boot. Plus, you have options again. Like Nightshade from our last review, Love and War has been adapted into a 2-hour audio play at Big Finish. I haven't listened to it, because those things are more expensive than a movie, but like last time, the reviews are good, and having heard her on other things, I know that Lisa Bowerman is phenomenal in giving Bernice Summerfield her voice. Love and War is another one of those books where a lengthy video essay like this is only scratching the surface. It's good, it's great, it's really sad and depressing, but the new characters and elements introduced here counter that a bit. Benny is delightful, and I can't wait for y'all to get to know her even more. Next time, the third member of the Cardinal Masterplan trio makes his entrance. Something evil is lurking within an intergalactic subway station, and the Doctor must team up with a descendant of an old friend and, I shit you not, Popeye the Sailor Man. Also, the most X-rated moment in Doctor Who history. Stay tuned.